Thank you. Well, first of all, Carla, let me thank you for having me here, and thank you for that very, very kind introduction. It may not have sounded like all that much to many of you, but you should know that before I began my work at the Unruh Institute, I taught for several years, one class each semester at the University of California, Berkeley. And as a Republican in Berkeley, I'm still not that used to people saying nice things about me in public, so I really appreciate it. And I want to thank all of you for having me here tonight. I've been teaching a course each semester at USC, both one in the Annenberg School and one in the Department of Political Science for the last 5 years now, and it's been a tremendous experience. But since starting as the director of the Unruh Institute this past fall, I've had the privilege of speaking not only to student groups, but to organizations such as this one, and getting a chance to meet firsthand the men and the women whose pride in USC and support for USC really has transformed it into one of the great universities in this country and on this planet. And so I'm going to talk a lot about the students tonight, but before I do, I'd like you to give each other and your fellow alumni across California and across the country and across the planet a round of applause, because one of the things I heard from President Sample, one of the things I heard from Dean Gilman, but one of the things I never knew until I started going out and talking to groups like this one, is how instrumental you have been in making the University of Southern California what it is today. So give yourselves a round of applause. Carl, I'm impressed they applauded you more than they applauded themselves. That's pretty impressive. So over the last few months, I have had the privilege of speaking to SC alumni groups around the Southland, and I'll be going to Washington and to New York and other cities throughout this year. I'm very excited about that. But I have to admit to you, a lot of these talks are at locations like the Burbank Airport Hilton, like the LAX Westin. So when I heard that the Newport Club wanted me here, it didn't take a lot of convincing at all. So thank you very much for allowing me to join you. I'm going to talk in a little bit about the Jesse M. Unruh Institute of Politics and what we're doing and why I think it's so important to help young people of all ideologies, of all major parties, involve themselves in politics and government and public service. But I know that that was not the featured topic for tonight's talk, and I do want to spend some time talking about contemporary American politics. Then I will talk a little bit about the Institute and our goals, and then of course I'm happy to answer any questions or comments or insults that any of you may have by the time I finish. One thing Carla did not tell you about me when she read my introduction is she talked to you about my political biography, she talked to you about my professional experience, but there's something from my personal experience that you ought to know, because it informs not only the way I teach but the way I approached campaign politics for many years. As you may have gathered from the candidates and office holders for whom I've worked for that Carla mentioned, I worked for many years in Republican politics. My job right now at Unruh is a completely nonpartisan one, and I work just as closely with the campus Democrats as with the campus Republicans and in a otherwise very wide range of campus student organizations. But while I'm a Republican and worked for many years in Republican politics, I should tell you that I come from a family of Democrats. I come from a family that is not just majority Democrat. I come from a family that is not just overwhelmingly majority Democrat. You too, huh? We're going to talk about Thanksgiving dinner in just a minute. You'll know exactly what I'm talking about. But I come from a family that is made up entirely of registered Democrats. Well, that's not quite true. Because when we gather every fall for Thanksgiving and for family events, weddings, and so forth, we have roughly 70 Schnurs and Schnur derivatives, and 68 are registered Democrats. My cousin Hannah is a registered member of the Green Party. And then there's me, the family pinata. So like I said, I'm really happy to be down here in the OC tonight, so thank you again for having me. And as I alluded to a moment ago, and it sounds like I've got a kindred spirit here, it presents a certain set of challenges that I've learned how to apply on the campaign trail and on campus over the years. Because, don't get me wrong, my family members and I, we love each other. We're a very close family. And we can give each other a hard time. We can make some fun at each other's expense about our different political and ideological leanings. But sometimes it gets a little bit testy. And as you, sir, might understand, and if any of the rest of you come from mixed families, you'll understand what I'm talking about. The real problem is the proximity on the calendar between Election Day and Thanksgiving Day. 2.5 weeks is just not enough time for people to calm down. If Election Day were in August, we'd have all fall to come to our senses. If Election Day were in the first week of November and Thanksgiving was in late January, early February, everyone would have plenty of time to cool out. But 2.5 weeks in November? Well, let's just say tensions generally are still running pretty high when I see my family members each fall. And some years are better than others. As you might guess, this past Thanksgiving was a particularly challenging one for me. I got a call about a week before Thanksgiving dinner. The way we work it is we rotate Thanksgiving every year between a bunch of us cousins. And this year my cousin Ronnie was hosting Thanksgiving, and he called me about a week before the dinner, before the Thanksgiving holiday. He said, "Hey, Dan, I want to ask you a favor." And I said, "Sure, Ron, anything." He said, "Dan, I hope I don't offend you." Now, you're smart people. You know that when somebody starts a sentence with the phrase, "I hope I don't offend you," that they're about to offend you. It's like when Brian and I were sitting at dinner tonight, we were talking politics, and I said, "Brian, with all due respect," there was no respect to follow anywhere in his immediate future. So you learn to look for these certain clues. He said, "Dan, I hope I don't offend you, but Obama won the presidential election. The Democrats hold Congress. The Democrats hold the Senate. So we were wondering if this year you'd be willing to sit at the kids' table, at the children's table for Thanksgiving dinner." Now, as you can tell by looking at me, it's been a while since I've sat at the kids' table on merit. He said, "But I hope you're not offended." I said, "Ronnie, I'll tell you I'm not offended, and I'll tell you why. I said, because I've been trying to talk some sense into you people for years. The adult members of my family, my cousins, my aunts, my uncles, my grandparents, you people are lost causes. Every year, every campaign, every election, I talk and I talk and I talk, and nothing ever changes. I'll never win you back. But the children." Yes, the children. So now I'm not allowed to play with my nieces and nephews anymore. Unless there's a court-appointed representative there from Common Cause of the League of Women Voters to keep an eye on things. And I tell this story, one, because I have a family wedding coming up in a couple weeks, and I will admit to you I'm getting a little bit nervous about it. But I tell it also because, as I mentioned a moment ago, it frames the discussion I want to have about today's political landscape. And I know that the title of this talk was "The Challenges Facing the New President and the New Administration." But rather than talking about an array of challenges, I want to talk about one challenge in particular, which will cover a whole range of issues and a whole range of policy matters that the new president and the new Congress are dealing. And that is the challenge, and I'll get to this in a little bit more detail in just a moment. To me, the most important challenge that President Obama faces is not necessarily a stimulus package per se, not necessarily Guantanamo exactly, not necessarily energy or the environment or healthcare or the other issues that he has prioritized, but rather a broader challenge that he faces. Is that as a candidate, Barack Obama said that he wanted change. And he said more specifically, he wanted to end politics as usual. And if you remember, when he ran against Senator Clinton in the Democratic primary, he talked about 20 years in both parties, Bush's, Clinton's, back and forth, he talked about both parties spending too much time engaged in finger-pointing, engaged in blame-laying, and he would lead a different type of administration. And if you listen to him during the campaign, if you listen to him on election night, and certainly if you listen to him last week in his inaugural address, that was the main theme that he has articulated over the last couple of years. And I would argue to you, as much as his position on any particular matter of public policy, what drew such broad public support to his campaign. And the challenge that Barack Obama faces is how to end politics as usual in a town that thrives on politics as usual. Now, we've seen this in California. Our governor, Arnold Schwarzenegger, after being reelected just over 2 years ago, proclaimed himself a post-partisan. And he said what he wanted to do is he wanted to borrow good ideas from Republicans and take good ideas from Democrats. Didn't matter if it was a Democrat or Republican idea. What mattered was whether it was a good idea. And the people wanted the partisan bickering to stop, and he was going to inaugurate an era of post-partisan governance in California. And he has tried. And I would suggest to you that after 2 years of trying, Arnold Schwarzenegger is in fact the loneliest post-partisan in the state capitol. Not because there are not good people of both parties throughout the state of California who share his sentiment. There are millions. But in a state capital populated disproportionately by only the most liberal of Democrats and only the most conservative of Republicans, that is people, again, good people, but people truly, madly, deeply committed to a particular cause and particular ideology. People who have built their entire careers on the old form of partisanship have no vested interest in putting that aside to adopt a new form of post-partisanship. And the challenge that Arnold Schwarzenegger has faced in California is a relatively simple one compared to the challenge, similar dynamic but much larger challenge, that President Obama faces at a national level. You know, it's funny, I talk about Schwarzenegger. For those of you who have trouble sleeping at night, you'll know what I'm talking about. Every once in a while, I'm having trouble sleeping, so I turn on the TV. And I'm watching TV last week, and this old movie came on. This movie made in the 1930s, 1940s, but it was set in the Civil War. It's a Bob Hope movie. And the Bob Hope character, has to get across the front line of battle. You got the Union on one side, the Confederate on the other, and Bob Hope's got to figure out a way to get across, even with both sides shooting at each other. So he thinks about it, and what his character does is he stitches together a uniform. And this uniform is gray on one side and blue on the other. And then he sews together a flag. And that flag on one side is stars and stripes, and on the other side is stars and bars. And Bob Hope puts on this uniform, and he holds up the flag, and he begins to walk across the battle line. And one by one, the soldiers on both sides see him and see their flag and see their colors. And they stop shooting, and they stand up. And they begin applauding, and they begin cheering, and they begin singing, and they begin crying. And as he walks across, the shooting stops, and you have this wonderful moment where both groups of soldiers committed to their cause and to their, and to their country are cheering and applauding for something they believe in. And Bob Hope swells up as he walks across the battle line, and he thinks, this is wonderful. I just love this. This was such a terrific idea. And he gets to the other side of the battlefield, and he says, you know what? That felt wonderful. That felt terrific. I'm going to turn around and do it again. And you can guess what happened, of course. And I would suggest to you, and I say this as somebody who is a fan of our current governor, if you watch Arnold Schwarzenegger attempting to negotiate this year's budget crisis, basically what you're seeing is Bob Hope walking back across the front battle lines, because Arnold Schwarzenegger is catching javelins from both the left and the right simultaneously, trying to stake out a political center that the majority of Californians may support, but the overwhelming majority of their elected representatives do not. Now, in my world, there are three kinds of people. And the three kinds of people are saints, sinners, and salvageables. And I want to take just a moment to define my terms. A saint is somebody who agrees with me. No matter what, all the time. What could possibly be more saintly? You get wings, you get a halo, you get a harp, you're with Schnur, you're in. You are a saint. And in a very narrow political sense, I know that in a statewide election in California or in a national election, that roughly 40% of the voters are going to be my saints. Under all but the most dire of circumstances, roughly 40% of the voters are going to vote for my party and my party's candidate, no matter what. Now, if 40% of the voters are saints, of course, that means that 40% of the voters are sinners. And again, this is very, very narrow terminology. I'm talking only about political preference, because as I told you a few minutes ago, some of the most important people in my life, by that definition, are sinners. My younger brother is an otherwise very bright young man who spent 7 years in the Clinton Gore administration. Sinner. My father, who voted for Senator Obama in the Wisconsin primary last spring and Howard Dean in the Wisconsin primary 4 years before that, even though he thought both were too conservative for his own tastes. Dad's a sinner. My stepmother, who has programmed our television set at home to use the V chip to block out the Fox News channel. sinner. I love these people. They're the most important people in my world. But when it comes to politics, no matter how much time or energy or oxygen I expend, there is nothing I could possibly do to convince them to vote for my candidates. And honestly, not really much they could do to get me to vote for theirs. Now, if 40% of the electorate are saints and 40% of the electorate are sinners, of course, what that leaves is a 20% swath of the electorate that are salvageable. And these salvageable voters are voters who are at least potentially available to a candidate of either major party. They might be independent voters, or as we call them in California, declined estates. They might be moderate Republicans or centrist Democrats, but they are willing to cross party lines in order to vote for a candidate who appeals to them. So a Democrat who votes for Schwarzenegger, a Republican who votes for Dianne Feinstein, these voters are salvageable. And these voters tend to decide elections in California and in national campaigns as well. And to go back and look at this last presidential campaign for just a couple of minutes, I think it's instructive to look at this salvageable group of voters, not in their entirety, but while there are dozens, if not hundreds, of subgroups of salvageable voters, there are two in particular who are of specific importance in this last campaign. And those two groups, and you've probably heard them discussed in the past, the two groups that I want to discuss for just a few minutes, are commonly known as soccer moms and NASCAR dads. Now, soccer moms, and more accurately, soccer parents, because this is not a gender-specific designation, soccer parents tend to be economically successful and therefore tend to be, not always, but tend to be more economically conservative. But as soccer parents, they also tend to be more moderate to sometimes liberal on a range of social and cultural and environmental issues. And for years and years and years, soccer parents, economically upscale, socially moderate voters, tended to vote Republican very loyally. And it was only in the 1990s when some smart Democrats like Bill Clinton and Dianne Feinstein reached out to these soccer parents that they moved them over. And the way they did that was by saying, listen, we're not those old tax and spend Democrats. We're new Democrats. And we are fiscally responsible as well. So since you can get a fiscally responsible candidate no matter which party you vote for, why don't you vote for the one with whom you agree on education or health care or environmental issues, or on abortion or gun control or same-sex marriage issues as well? And what Clinton and Feinstein and other Democrats did is they gradually moved this whole cohort from the Republican Party to the Democrats. Now, at the same time, Republicans just weren't sitting there letting this happen. They reached out, though, to another group of salvageable voters, NASCAR dads, or again, to be more accurate, NASCAR parents, because this is a non-gender-specific designation as well. Parents of both parties were working class, blue-collar, and therefore tended to be more economically populist, but on cultural and social issues tended to be more conservative on issues like abortion and guns and on same-sex marriage. And so for those of you who are sports fans, you can probably look back over the years and think about a trade that really was seminal in your life. Shaq going to the Heat, Gasol coming to the Lakers, Wilt from the Sixers. Yeah, you pick your favorite team, Dodgers, Lakers, whoever, and you're going to remember a trade that's really, really motivated you. And for those of you who are sports fans in the room that are supposed to be in the other room, you know what I'm talking about here. Well, the trade that dwarfed all of these, the trade that dwarfed the trades for Shaq, for Kareem, for Wilt, was the massive trade that the Democrats and Republicans pulled off over the course of about 20 years, in which the Democrats acquired soccer parent moms in exchange for NASCAR dads. So for a variety of reasons, heading into the summer and in the fall of the 2008 campaign, it had become pretty clear that in particular these NASCAR parents were going to decide the election for a variety of reasons. And it became very clear that if John McCain was going to be elected president, he needed to find a way to attract a majority of support from these voters because Obama was attracting very high levels of support, even higher than Bill Clinton, from soccer parents. And the irony here in the summer of 2008 is that here we have a group of voters, these NASCAR parents, who both campaigns knew were absolutely critical to their fortunes. And neither candidate had any idea of how to talk to them. Neither candidate had any idea of how to talk to these NASCAR dads and NASCAR moms. And if you look back at the primaries, Barack Obama almost lost the Democratic nomination in states like Ohio and Pennsylvania and West Virginia and others, because he had such a difficult time reaching out to these working class voters who instead preferred the candidacy of Senator Clinton. And John McCain, while his primary season was much shorter, more because of the rules of the Republican Party than any other real difference, during the relatively short time that the Republican nomination was contested, he too tended to lose the party's most culturally conservative voters to Governor Huckabee, to Governor Romney, and for a short time to Senator Thompson. So here they are heading into the home stretch of the general election. Neither candidate really knew how to talk to these people. So what did they do? Well, the first thing they did is they picked running mates. And Joey B. from Scranton, Pennsylvania, and the hockey mom from Wasilla, Alaska, these are NASCAR parents, or at least they know how to talk to them. And both Joe Biden and Sarah Palin were picked for any number of reasons, but I would argue to you that no reason was more important, at least from a political as opposed to a governing perspective, is their ability to reach out to these group of salvageable voters. And as the campaign progressed into the fall, Barack Obama and John McCain fought tooth and nail for these voters. And early in the month of September, they had fought pretty much to a draw, not only among NASCAR parents, but among the entire electorate. The race was pretty much tied. And then something happened. Something more important than a speech that either candidate gave, an ad that either campaign ran, anything that happened, any of the debates or the conventions. What happened? Well, those of you who are active in the stock market, or those of you who were once active in the stock market, you know exactly what I'm talking about. At this time of night, on the evening of September 13th, John McCain was actually enjoying a very slight lead in the polls. And on September 14th, Lehman Brothers collapsed. And then Wall Street collapsed. And they collapsed right on the top of the and they collapsed right on top of John McCain. And even though there was a formality that demanded that the campaign continue for another 6 or 7 weeks, on September 14th, the 2008 election was pretty much over. Because as angry and as anxious and as upset as all Americans were watching what was happening to our economy, it was those most economically precarious voters, working class, blue collar, soccer parents, who were affected the most immediately and the most dramatically. And Republicans who reach out to these voters on social and cultural issues when they are successful, and had been doing a relatively decent job of that up until the morning of September 14th, well, all of a sudden, the social and cultural arguments seemed a lot less important to people who were about to lose their house. And so Obama, who had already locked up the soccer votes, was able to reach out to these NASCAR parents on economic grounds and essentially seal the election for himself. So Barack Obama is elected president. He takes office. And once again, in his inaugural address, he proclaims that he wants to end politics as usual. And what we've seen, getting back to the greatest challenge he faces, is ending politics as usual in a town, in a culture that thrives on politics as usual. And Barack Obama wants to end politics as usual, but Nancy Pelosi never said that she wanted to. And John Boehner and Mitch McConnell never said that they wanted to either. And so here walks Barack Obama, at least right now, down that first stretch of road on a Civil War battlefield. And already, though, you're beginning to see signs, not just from Republicans, but from Democrats as well, of a very, very short honeymoon period for a president who intends to take only the best from both parties. President Obama proposed a stimulus package that allocated roughly 40% of the money in that package to tax cuts and roughly 60% to increased spending. Well, for Democrats in Congress, that was way too much in the way of tax cuts and not nearly enough in the way of spending. For Republicans, of course, that wasn't nearly enough in the way of tax cuts and was much too much in the way of spending. And so the challenge for President Obama, it seems to me, whether it's on the stimulus package, whether it's on issues of national security, whether and how to pull our troops from Iraq, whether or how to close Guantanamo, whether or how to preserve presidential authority when dealing with some very, very bad customers in some very, very dangerous parts of the world, is how does he chart that middle course? And how does he take the enormous public popularity that he enjoys and convince Democrats who are well to the left of him and Republicans who are well to the right that the people who elected him, at least in part, elected him because they wanted to see something different? And that is his greatest challenge. Will he solve it? I don't know. I don't pretend to know. We had, as Carla mentioned, we had one of our we call them the Students Talk Back Lunches on campus today. And we always bring in a couple of guest speakers to talk. And one of the people who came today was Bob Hertzberg, the former Speaker of the California State Assembly. And I asked him this question because I knew I was going to have to talk about it tonight, and I figured I could steal from him. And Bob, who's a really great guy, and boy, if you think I can talk a lot, Bob will talk to you forever and a day, gave a very long, very intelligent answer. And what it, if I were to sum it up, he would say, what you've asked Dan, whether Barack Obama can accomplish, it is an impossible task, but he just might be able to pull it off. Now, can he? Like I said, I don't know. Will he? I don't know. But I will say this, as someone who, as you might guess, did not vote for him last November, I will tell you that I'm tremendously encouraged by what I have seen so far in that regard. Do I agree with the public policy agenda that candidate Obama articulated on the campaign trail, or everything that he has talked about from a public policy standpoint as President Obama? No, I do not. But I watch the determination with which he is working to try to, if not end, change politics as usual in Washington, D.C., and I must tell you I'm encouraged. The first thing that Barack Obama did as president-elect, one of the first things he did, is he appointed a chief of staff. And the chief of staff, and I think most of you are well-read people, you know, is the former congressman from Illinois, Rahm Emanuel. And to me, this is a very important signal, not only about how he would run the White House, but about how the president would try to establish a post-partisan center in the political debate. Because there's three important things to know about Rahm Emanuel. Number one, he's smart. He's one of the smartest people I've ever worked with or against in politics. Number two, he's experienced. And not only experienced in terms of quantity of experience, but as some of you may know, he worked as a White House staffer under Bill Clinton. So Rahm Emanuel had a front row seat when the last Democratic president was dragged leftward by well-meaning allies of his in a Democratic-controlled Congress in the early 1990s. And Rahm Emanuel remembers all too well what happened to President Clinton when he was dragged off the center by well-meaning Democratic allies. And third, and perhaps most importantly, Rahm Emanuel is mean. And I would suggest to you that there are circumstances in which you do not want a mean person in a trusting position, like a surgeon, for example. But for a White House chief of staff, it's a pretty good quality to have. Some of you may have heard the story, and I like to say there are some stories that are so good it doesn't matter if they're true or not. There is a story that when Rahm Emanuel was a campaign worker, he became so enraged, so outraged at another campaign worker that he had delivered to this man's office, wrapped in newspaper, a dead fish. And I would suggest to you that this president, this administration, and this country will be very, very well served if the chief of staff Emanuel were to engineer such deliveries in a steady stream from one end of Pennsylvania Avenue to the other over the next 4 years. And to say to not only Republicans but to Democrats, he got elected president, you didn't. So get with the program. And I think Barack Obama understands it for another reason too. And this to me, I've been watching him for a couple years, and I've been trying to figure out for most of those 2 years what exactly it is that makes him so unique and so compelling. And that does not mean he enjoys unanimous support, but he is a very, very, very rarely talented individual when it comes to the practice of politics. And one thing I found, certainly not the only thing, but one thing I found that I think is particularly important is that most politicians define success as being able to give everybody everything that they want. And I think Barack Obama is smart enough and fairly unique in this respect to understand that the key to political success for him is not to give everybody everything that they want, but rather to make sure that nobody has absolutely everything they want. And so when he asks Rick Warren to give the invocation at his inaugural address, he is sending a message to his most loyal supporters, the liberal base of the Democratic Party, and saying, hey, look, I love you guys, and I'm going to work with you, but if this is going to happen the way it's supposed to, you can't have everything you want. Because if anyone gets everything they want, whether it's the most liberal of Democrats or the most conservative of Republicans or anyone in between, if somebody gets everything they want, that means that somebody else isn't getting anything. And in order to steer a ship through these very precarious partisan waters, I think Obama has realized that just because, not only of his own skills, but of this very, very unique period in history in which this country finds itself, that people, perhaps more than under most circumstances, are willing not to get everything they want. The term Rahm Emanuel uses is saying, he says, everyone needs to have some skin in the game. But to me, the most instructive thing of watching this new president as he moves forward is not to watch who he makes happy, but how he makes them mad. Because if there is any member of Congress, Democrat or Republican, House or Senate, who is completely satisfied by everything the Obama administration does, that means there are a lot of other members who are angry and unwilling to cooperate under any circumstances. Of course, he has to make choices. No question, he has to make choices, and it seems that he is making them on this stimulus package. Being a postpartisan doesn't mean compromising on everything. But this is an extraordinary challenge under extraordinarily challenging times. Challenging economic times, challenging national security times, challenging social and cultural times. And I don't know if he can succeed. But I will say this, as someone who did not vote for him, I hope he succeeds. And for every one of you in this room, whether you supported him or John McCain or anyone else for president, I would hope that you hope he succeeds as well. Because I've worked in politics for many, many years, I've picked up a bad habit from the candidates I've worked for. I tend to talk a lot longer than I'm supposed to. And I certainly do, before we let you out of here, I do want to tell you a little bit about the Institute and a little bit about what's going on campus in terms of political activity. But you've been very patient and very gracious. And so maybe, at least for a while right now, Carla, if you think it's all right, maybe we can open it up to some questions and have a conversation rather than just a monologue. Ma'am. Why did Barack Obama pick Hillary Clinton to be a Secretary of State? I think for several reasons, one of which I think is the one you correctly identified, is not so much as an enemy to Barack Obama, but as a potential opponent to him should his administration not be judged successful. Well, putting her at Foggy Bottom pretty much eliminates the chance that she's going to be a candidate for president 4 years from now. So I think a very, very savvy way of eliminating what would be the greatest in-party threat to his presidency, because it is worth noting that the last two incumbent presidents who faced significant primary challenges, George Bush Sr., or as some now call him, Bush Classic, in 1992 when he ran against Pat Buchanan, and of course all the way back to Jimmy Carter when he ran against Ted Kennedy in 1980, the last two incumbent presidents who had significant primary challenges won those primary challenges, but were sufficiently weakened that they lost their general election campaign. And at the most political Machiavellian level, having Hillary Clinton on the world stage keeps her out of Iowa and New Hampshire. But I also think, and again, I say this for any number of reasons, I think he also realized that his own focus as president was going to be almost unilaterally on the nation's domestic and economic matters for the foreseeable future. In that in order to send a signal to the rest of the world that he was not simply turning inward and was ignoring the need for us to build our strength and relationships with the rest of the world, sending someone who is that well known and that well respected, I think sends a very powerful signal to our allies and our not so allies. And of course, finally, Obama was asked during the campaign about the prospect of Hillary as a running mate, and in which he gave a very diplomatic answer, in which he talked about the, I believe the word he used was complications of having a former president, particularly this particular former president wandering around the halls of the West Wing. And I think the president and his, advisors recognized that as difficult as it would be having 2.5 presidents in the White House at once, having two Clintons on the world stage is something that could be the great benefit of the administration and the country. So I said any number of reasons, but I will say this. I think it was a smart choice. Ma'am. What did David Axelrod get out of the administration? Well, he got probably, number one, about the best job you can get in any presidential administration. a very, very, very senior level job without day-to-day responsibilities. And when you can be a senior advisor to a president without having a reporting structure under you, that is the best of both worlds. And I will say this, I believe he earned it. What else did he gain? He gained the president, he gained the ear of the most powerful person on the planet. And I say this also, I believe he earned it. Because I think to watch the Obama campaign, not so much in the general election, because particularly after the Wall Street collapse, it pretty much was a fait accompli. But if you watch the brilliance of the Obama campaign during the primary, you have to give a lot of credit to the people who ran that campaign. And I say that for two reasons. I'm digressing for a moment, but I think it's worth taking some time, because if you had had me 2 years ago to talk here, I would have told you with only the confidence that can be mustered by a professional pundit that without any doubt whatsoever that Hillary Rodham Clinton was going to be the Democratic nominee for President of the United States. I used to like to say that I regarded the Clintons the same way I regard the UCLA basketball team. I don't like them. I root against them. I want them to lose, and I will admit that in some weak moments I want bad things to happen to them. But they're really, really good at what they do. And if somebody can knock them out along the way, whether it's Oregon or Obama, I am all for it. Now, be careful of what you ask for, because I think what Obama did in the primary are two things. And a lot of it was Barack Obama, but a lot of it was David Axelrod and his campaign manager, David Plouffe. They did two especially brilliant things. Number one, by talk, they understood far better than Clinton and her advisors exactly how hungry, exactly how starved, exactly how desperate a Democratic primary electorate was for change. Now, Senator Clinton and her advisors made what at the time seemed to be a very, very smart decision, because she was the first female ever to run for president with a plausible chance of winning. They decided to stress her experience, her credentials. And what Obama and his campaign did masterfully is by talking about change, particularly the way they did, they made it so that every time Hillary Clinton talked about experience, what Democratic primary voters heard was more of the same. Same old thing. And the more she talked about experience and the more she talked about her credentials, the more she looked like part of the problem that Barack Obama was trying to solve. The other thing that Axelrod and Plouffe did, and I promise to start giving shorter answers after this, wasn't nearly as visual, wasn't nearly as obvious from a broader message standpoint. But they made a very smart decision at a tactical level. Democrats and Republicans pick their delegates in primaries in very different ways. And actually, the differences between the way those selection processes work really reflect the different, not so much the different philosophies, but the different personalities of the two parties. Republicans, we award our delegates winner take all. If you win a state even by one vote, you get all the delegates. Why? We're pretty Darwinian. You win, you lose, you keep going, you're going home. That's it. And it's very efficient and it works very well most of the time. Democrats have a proportional system because Democrats are more nurturing. They say, you didn't lose this primary. You finished second. Have some delegates and some ice cream and you'll feel better. And what the Obama campaign figured out is they didn't have to win primaries in states like California and New York and Texas. They could finish second and pick up enough delegates, combined with wins in small or ignored states, that by the time Hillary Clinton and her advisors figured out what was going on, well, he was already on his way to the nomination. So long answer, but to the point, David Axelrod deserves whatever the president's allowed to give him. Sorry? And historically, those caucus states tended to have been red states. They tended to be states that voted Republican. And so the Clinton campaign said, we're going to concentrate on big primary states like California and New York that tend to vote Democratic. And the Obama campaign realized, look, we don't need to win Nebraska and Montana in the fall. We just need to win a few delegates from those caucuses in the spring. And again, very, very adroitly put together strategy. Yes, ma'am. For those of you who didn't hear the question, let me repeat it. First of all, the young woman congratulated me on the brilliance of my presentation. She said it was absolutely fascinating, and that she was just riveted from beginning to end. But she pointed out accurately that there's an awful lot of people in this country who did not vote for Barack Obama, and who, like me, did not necessarily agree with his public policy agenda. Yet she pointed out, I said I wanted him to succeed. And this is actually a variation of the conversation which our friend Rush Limbaugh has found himself over the last several days. He said he hoped that Obama would fail and has since then sort of clarified by saying that he doesn't want Obama or the nation to fail, but rather wants Obama's initial public policy priorities to be unsuccessful so something that he thinks will be more successful can be implemented instead. And I guess I would come at it from roughly the same perspective, and I'll say again, just as a reminder, while I spent many years working in Republican politics, and while I think my loyalties, I've been pretty clear here, in the position I hold at the Unruh Institute and in the presentation I've made tonight, I really do see my role here as an analyst rather than an advocate. With that caveat in mind, I do not agree with everything, with many things in the stimulus package. My personal preference would be something different than this. But that said, I recognize, as I have heard John McCain and George Bush and others say over the years, that elections have consequences. And I realize that when President Obama decides, for example, to take certain aspects, certain amendments out of the stimulus package in order to attract Republican support, I see him making his best effort to steer toward bipartisan governance. And bipartisan doesn't mean that one side gets 50% and the other side gets 50%. The side that wins is going to get more. And when I'm on the side that wins, I think that's fine. When I'm on the side that loses, I realize that that's the way things work. So when I say I want him to succeed, I guess what I was talking about more generally is I want to see him succeed at his efforts toward ending the kind of finger-pointing politics as usual that has undermined our political process. Again, that doesn't mean I agree with everything he's doing. I agree with a lot of it, but not all. But my point was toward his approach to governance rather than toward any particular public policy solution. So I hope that helps. Sir. The question was, what did I think of the passage of the stimulus package purely along party lines? I was disappointed, and I suspect the president was as well, albeit for different reasons. Why did it go down that way? Because I think, we can talk substantively about the differences between the Republican alternative, what the Democratic Congress originally proposed, and what Obama ultimately settled on. And Obama's is not quite exactly in the middle, but somewhere to the left of the Republican and somewhere to the right of the Democratic congressional plan. Obama made efforts. Give him some credit for that. He saw that Republicans were particularly upset about money in the stimulus package for family planning. And a lot of Republicans made the argument that said, whether you think the United States government ought to be spending money on family planning or not, it's hard to argue that that is economic stimulus, although Speaker Pelosi gave it her best shot at making that argument this past Sunday. But he took that out of the bill. And I would guess, I don't know for sure, I would guess that in his perfect world, President Obama would like to see that money for family planning in his stimulus bill. But he took it out, and he took some other things out as well in order to attempt to attract Republican support. And I suspect what finally happened, it's not over yet, we'll see what happens in the Senate. I think at this point, Obama decided, I don't need Republican votes to pass this. I'd like that some, because it sends a strong message to the country. But I don't need them, and I can get along without them. And I think when this argument moves to the Senate, you will see a little bit more horse trading back and forth. And I think you will see Obama trying as hard as he can, not just to pass the bill with 60 votes, but to find a way to frame the stimulus bill in a way that it can pass with 65, 70, or more votes. Not with the majority of Republicans, but with Republicans who don't live in Maine, for example, as a starting point. And will he get there? I don't know. but I'm willing to bet that he'll make a strong effort for all the reasons I was talking about a few minutes ago.
Here. As your relative said, I hope you will take a test.
Wow. I should sit down and let you talk for a while. I want to hear some of that.
But I wanted to ask you specifically about the problem in Washington about being nonpartisan or working together. Because 8 years ago, President Bush came to Washington on almost that same type of thought. He was a bipartisan governor of Texas and was totally unsuccessful. We can talk about whether it's his fault or not.
Yeah.
Where do you see the difference between the two as far as Obama and Bush's way of doing things? I mean, I see two. Number one, the way that he handled both Joe Lieberman, he really did make the Democrats act back.
Well, you make a good point. Barack Obama is not the first president to proclaim that he wants to establish a bipartisan way of doing business in Washington, D.C. George Bush did it. Bill Clinton said it. George Bush the Older, Ronald Reagan, Jimmy Carter. Most presidents say it. Some mean it more than others, but all make some effort in that direction. And I'd suggest to you that the biggest difference, and there's certainly any number of differences between Barack Obama and George W. Bush, and that's a separate conversation. And I mentioned you at least one thing that I thought he had recognized in terms of leaving people wanting more that I think lends itself to that approach. But to me, the biggest difference that might allow this president a chance for success has nothing to do with the personal or political differences between Barack Obama and George Bush. Rather, it's not the person, it's the circumstances. I have a theory which I will not bore you with in its entirety, but I call it the politics of hunger. And the hungrier people get, the more afraid they get, the more concerned they get, the more willing they are to try something new. I like to say everyone's a victim of their own success. And as long as things are going well, it's only human nature to want to keep doing things the way you've always done them. Well, regardless of who you blame, there are any number of borderline catastrophic circumstances, the challenges that this country now faces. And maybe the breadth and depth of those challenges can create a more cohesive working environment. So I would say more than the individual is a moment in history that provides me at least some degree of optimism in that regard. I'll lean back. It's a great question. I think what the young woman asked is about the use of technology in this past campaign, and there's no question that the Obama campaign pioneered the uses of extraordinary forms of communications technology that had never been applied in campaign politics before. Now, for those of you who work in the private sector in the tech field, you know what they did is not particularly remarkable, but politics tends to be a lagging indicator in these things. We tend to, if you look back over American history, candidates didn't start running well-crafted television commercials until long after automakers did. And similarly, it's not surprising that it took a long time after the rest of the country had figured out social networking for a presidential campaign to figure out a way to use it to its benefit. But give the Obama campaign credit, they took these technologies and they applied them very, very effectively. I guess 2 points. Number one is, why did Barack Obama and his campaign figure this out more than the Republicans? It goes back to what I was saying a moment ago about the politics of hunger. The out party, When you're hungry, when you haven't been invited to the White House for a state dinner in a long time, you get hungry, and when you get hungry, you get innovative and you get creative. And if you think back, Franklin Roosevelt's use of radio and John F. Kennedy's use of television, both were born in attitudes that existed during the Republican administrations that preceded their taking office. And Republican use of talk radio and cable television really flourished during the years that Bill Clinton was president. So the out party has much more of an incentive to try new things. And obviously Republicans, for the last 60 days, have a much greater incentive to try those new things, and I suspect you'll see the two parties come to more of an equilibrium by 2012. But the challenge going forward, and I think this is why your question is so important, is what Obama's trying to do is something that's never been successfully done in American politics before. And that is to take the enthusiasm and the energy that was developed on behalf of his candidacy during a campaign and apply that toward the business of governance and tell all these people who worked so hard or were so excited about his election and say, we need to be just as excited about Section 12, paragraph sub C of the economic stimulus bill. And that's hard to do. Once again, presidents have tried to do this in the past. Every president tries to do this. The difference is, most presidents, when they try to mobilize support on behalf of their policy initiatives, when they try to turn back to their political supporters and ask them for support in implementing a governing agenda, they turn to their political parties, to the Democratic National Committee, to the Republican National Committee. And those party organizations, in addition to helping the president with his policy agenda, are also dedicated to electing and reelecting their party's candidates at every level of government, and sometimes those goals come into conflict. And what Obama's attempting to do, given the tools of technology that no other president has had, is saying, even though I happen to be housing this at the Democratic National Committee, this isn't a Democratic Party thing. And if I have to pressure some Democrats to do what I think is right, even if they don't want to, I'm going to use this organization to do it. And certainly I'm more than happy to pressure Republicans as well. But the ability of this technology to mobilize people, to engage voters, to make voters part of a conversation rather than just on the receiving end of a monologue, something we haven't seen in the modern era of American politics. We never saw it in campaigns until last year, and we've never seen it in government, and we may this year. It's an extraordinary experiment. I don't know if it'll work, but it's going to be fascinating to watch. Ma'am? You know, it's a fascinating point. She mentions the fact that President Obama gave his first media interview to an Arab television network. And if you watch, it's exactly right, if you watch the interview or if you read the transcript, you will see that substantively, President Obama did not say anything, as near as I can tell, except perhaps the fact that he had once lived in a Muslim country. But substantively, he did not say anything different than George W. Bush would have said during his first week in office. He said the same thing about the Israelis and the Palestinians. He said the same thing about reaching out to the Arab world. Substantively, I do not think there was a single syllable uttered that George Bush could not have said. The difference, and you put your finger right on it, is he made it his very first broadcast interview. Substantively, that's not a change of policy. I'm sorry? Well, and as he joked during the campaign, he said, my name is Barack Hussein Obama, and I was named by somebody who never thought I was going to want to run for president of the United States. But even though substantively he has not changed his position on any of the issues that he discussed, it sends a very important symbolic message, one that I, from what I've read, has been very well received in the Arab world, and one, interestingly, which was not received poorly in Israel either. So again, strategically speaking, a very smart tactic. Well, once again, a great question that even once we get done talking about this economic stimulus package, there are broader problems that this administration needs to be addressing. And such is the nature of the American news media that it's a lot more fun to talk about tax cuts versus spending than it is to try to figure out what Tim Geithner has been asked to do over at the Treasury Department on all sorts of fronts. I don't pretend to know what the solution is. But I guess I'd make a couple of quick points. One, no one knows. This is unprecedented. This is unprecedented territory in which our economy, in which our country has found ourselves. And you see people talk with absolute certainty that the way to get us out of this crisis is to spend, and to spend quick. There are other people who will tell you that the best way to get out of this mess is to give the money back to the voters in forms of tax cuts and let them spend and spend quick. Income tax cuts, payroll tax, you can argue it in all sorts of different ways. The honest to gosh truth is no one knows, because we've never been here before. And clearly, there's consensus, not unanimous, but there's consensus in Washington that something must be done, that letting this economy drift without anything to stimulate it is a recipe for a longer-term recession, the likes of which Japan saw not so long ago. But if anyone stands up and says, I know with absolute certainty that this is what will get us out of it, or that is, they're not telling you the truth, because they don't know. And perhaps that speaks to the most important quality of a president of either party, his or someday her ability to inspire confidence in the people who elected them. And the ability of Barack Obama or George Bush or John McCain or Bill Clinton or Hillary Clinton or whoever it happens to be to stand before the American people and say, this can work. Psychologically, I would suggest to you is as important as the economic benefits of a stimulus package. Do you want to switch for you want to switch for Thanksgiving? What do you think?
I was so that of course engendered a lot of really exciting debates at Christmas time. So I kind of wanted your take on where you think the Republican Party should go from here.
Where should the Republican Party go from here? Well, I say this as somebody who devoted the first 20 years of my professional life to the Republican Party and its candidates. We have massive potential for growth. Where should the Republican Party go? You know, up. But you probably want me to be a bit more specific than that, so I will be. I'd offer you two thoughts. The first is, when Republicans last faced this situation, having lost the White House and seeing Democratic control of both houses of Congress, at this very moment almost in 1993, he saw a very rapid and a very pronounced shift of power in the party from Washington out to the states. And it's always been puzzling to me that it takes an electoral catastrophe for that to happen, because Republicans tend to be much less trusting of large centralized government to begin with. You would think that the party's natural tendency would be to look outside of Washington to states for innovation. And it's only in the absence of a Republican president or Republican Congress that the party does so. And if you look back to the early 1990s, you saw governors like John Engler in Michigan, like Tommy Thompson in Wisconsin, who is the leader in welfare reform, Arnie Carlson in Minnesota, Terry Branstad in Iowa, George Voinovich in Ohio, a gaggle of Republican governors whose states became the laboratories for policy innovation that allowed the party to ultimately come back. And I suspect the same thing will happen over the next years going forward. You know, the governors that get the most attention today, of course, are Governor Palin and Governor Jindal. But if you look around the country, you see people like Mitch Daniels in Indiana, like Mark Sanford in South Carolina, like John Huntsman in Utah. And I suspect over the next 2-4 years, you're going to see a similar dynamic take place where these governors begin to establish policy alternatives that ultimately at some point Congress turns to for possible guidance. But it begs a larger question. And I was talking earlier about soccer parents and NASCAR parents, and of course, ultimately it would cost John McCain the presidency. Was the decision of these voters that they were more willing to trust the Democratic candidate than the Republican candidate on economic matters? This was not a national security election like 2002. It was not a social and cultural election to a large degree like 2004. This was an election about the economy. And I remember when I got involved in campaign politics, this was a problem the Democrats were struggling with. And they had struggled with it at that point for almost half a century, trying to decide what to do with the economic principles of Franklin Roosevelt. And for year after year, election after election, they argued about whether it was time to abandon the Roosevelt economic agenda. Some said, no, we need to hold on to it. Others said, we need to get rid of it. And it took a half a century until Bill Clinton and the Democratic Leadership Council finally helped the party understand, albeit temporarily, that the answer wasn't to abandon Franklin Roosevelt's economic principles, nor was it to cling to them mindlessly either. Rather, it was to update a valuable set of economic principles for a different environment and a different set of challenges for a different time. And I wonder, a Reagan economic agenda, one that I would argue is still extremely valid to the point where the Democratic nominee for president ran for president calling for tax cuts for 95% of the American people. If that economic agenda that was developed more than 30 years ago at a time when Detroit was the economic centerpiece of this country in a much different way than it is today, if that agenda does not need to be abandoned, but nor does it need to be clung to, but perhaps does it need to be updated for the new challenges of a new political environment, of a new economic environment, of a new global environment. And I think as you see the center of political and ideological gravity shift for the Republican Party from Washington out to the states, you're going to see those questions addressed in a more considered manner than they have been in recent years. Great question, especially from an Obama campaign worker. Wow. Yes. Is there a Republican rising star who's going to make a significant political impact in the future we don't know about now? Yes. Next question. there is. And as I said, and we don't know who that person is, and I'm reminded of how foolish it is to try to project it because, like I said, 2 years ago I would have told you that Hillary Clinton was going to be the Democratic nominee for president. If we were sitting here 4 years ago tonight, we would have been talking about whether George Allen or Bill Frist would have made a better Republican nominee for president. Times change awfully quickly. And so the question that inevitably comes up is the question about Governor Palin. And I guess because I'm not very good, as you've already noticed, at predicting the future, I tend to look for lessons from the past. So rather than trying to guess where Sarah Palin's going to be in 4 years, rather I look back for lessons to the last several running mates of defeated presidential candidates. And I look back at John Edwards. I look back at Joe Lieberman. I look back at Jack Kemp. And I look back at Dan Quayle. And what do I see among the what did the four have in common? That 2 months after their running mate lost the general election, all four of them were considered to be their front runner for their party's nomination 4 years later, if for no other reason than they had been the most visible member of their party except for the defeated nominee over the last several months. Now, three of those candidates ran for president. None of them gained their party's nomination. Am I saying therefore that Sarah Palin will not be the Republican nominee for president? No, I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying that it's really easy to get hopped up 46 and a half months before people go to the polls. And so while Palin and Jindal in particular are two people who will play an important role in the party going forward, I think the governors who I just mentioned, each one of them has a potential important role to play going forward. Governor Paul Entey of Minnesota, there are plenty of Republican state houses around the country. There are 22 Republican governors, one of whom is constitutionally ineligible to run for president of the United States. The other 21 of whom, I guess you will be booking flights either to Des Moines, Iowa, or to Manchester, New Hampshire at some point in the next 6 months. But there's others as well. There's Paul Ryan from Wisconsin. There's Kevin McCarthy from the Central Valley here in California. There's John Shadegg from Arizona. There's plenty of smart Republican leaders both in Congress and in the state houses. But even I'm not dumb or presumptuous enough to figure out which one is going to be the answer to your question. I'm sorry? The question was about new young leaders. I'm sorry? So somebody, I was giving a talk like this a couple weeks ago, and somebody suggested, aren't the American voters just shallow? Why don't they just vote for the most attractive candidate in every election? I said, I don't know, go over to Romney headquarters and ask them. I would not be surprised if Governor Romney decided to run for president again in the future. On the other hand, I wouldn't be surprised if he didn't. It's hard. I was talking about the four vice presidential nominees earlier. Well, if for those of you who remember, after Jack Kemp lost the vice presidential race in 96, he thought very seriously about running for president. He decided not to, and they asked him why not. He said, I'm just not ready to spend 310 of the next 365 nights in Holiday Inns. And I think the Republican Party in particular generally tends to reward experience, which would certainly give Romney an advantage should he decide to run. But I'm not going to presume that anyone from the class of 2008, simply because they were part of that class, is automatically part of the class of 2012. If he does run, clearly he's a formidable candidate, and certainly a more experienced candidate, not vulnerable to the types of errors he made this last time out. But I think it's presumptuous, even given the fact that he's already become politically active again, to assume that it's a race that's going to happen. I think it can create jobs. I remember several years ago hearing about a magic formula called ethanol. And what we learned after pouring gazillions, and that's an exact figure, by the way, gazillions of dollars of subsidies into it, we learned, in fact, that it was more expensive and less environmentally sound than petroleum. So I think we can, but this is one of the real challenges of the economic stimulus package. Because, of course, as we were talking about earlier, the one thing that everybody seems to agree on is you got to inject this money into the economy fast. The problem is a lot of the kind of green technologies that you're talking about don't come fast. Solar, the wind, the biofuels, this is going to take a while. And it's a lot easier to spend half a gazillion dollars on a new road or a new bridge because you know that money is going to be circulated in the economy immediately, rather than spending for the long haul in order to invest in the kind of things that are going to get you your vacation home in the not too distant future. Already have it. Okay, got it. And I don't know how Obama's going to resolve this, because you know every dollar that he spends on long-term investment is a dollar that doesn't go into the economy at a time when most people would agree it's desperately needed, whether you think it's needed in the form of tax cuts or spending increases. And to me, of all of his policy challenges, that is by far the most interesting, not just because it was a campaign promise, because I'd argue it is the right thing to do, but it flies right in the face of a right now thing to do. And I wish I had a better answer, but I don't know. And if you do, please tell me afterwards and I'll invest. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Do I think President Obama will be the first president to use the line item veto? No, I don't. And I think what past presidents have found is that the threat of it is pretty valuable. And unless this president, well, let me back up for half a sec. This stimulus package, whether you like it or not, whether you think the Democratic version, the Obama version, or the Republican version is the right one to go, all three have got an awful lot of wasted money in it. And that money isn't as much pork as it is grease. It greases the wheels of governments. If I give Carla a big pot of money for something that she really doesn't need, and that gets me a vote for my stimulus package, well, then maybe it wasn't such a bad way to spend money. If she wants a bridge to nowhere, yeah, I don't care. But if I get her vote for what I need. And that is yet another obstacle to ending or changing politics as usual. Because there needs to be a lot of grease in a package like that in order to, develop the kind of votes that you need for passage. And of course, that provides another very powerful disincentive against line item veto. Because if I line item veto her bridge to nowhere out of the budget, well, maybe I need that vote. So he'll threaten it, and he'll use it to great effect, because he's a pretty savvy negotiator from what I can tell. But I'd be surprised if he's the first to use it. Well, I guess the presumption of the question, as I took it, was would he aggressively seek it? And the answer is probably not, for the reasons I was talking about. Interestingly enough, you know, most states, of course, have the line item veto. In my home state of Wisconsin, former Governor Thompson actually proclaimed, as finally ruled unconstitutional by the state Supreme Court, that he vetoed out not only lines out of the state budget and out of bills, but he vetoed words out of bills. You take the word not out of a piece of legislation, and you can pretty dramatically change its meaning. Anyway, the courts caught up with them, but it was fun to watch for a while. It's all the way in back. How do I think he will do in the international arena? Well, once again, this is a tough one for him. And as I mentioned earlier, I think it's one of the reasons I thought naming Senator Clinton as the Secretary of State did send a message to the rest of the world, not necessarily in terms of ideology, but in terms of important priority. He said, I'm sending somebody who you already know, I'm sending somebody who's very high profile, so forth. But this is going to be tough also. I mean, the Europeans have made sport out of Bush bashing for the last several years. And I think Tom Friedman wrote a very good column on this shortly after Obama was elected. And the column was something to the effect of put your money where your mouth is. Said, okay, you wanted Obama instead of McCain. You wanted Obama instead of Bush. Okay, let's see some more troops in Afghanistan. Let's see a multinational effort in other trouble spots around the world. As we're seeing just this week, let's see you take some of these Guantanamo prisoners that really don't belong in Kansas or Illinois or California. And so I think he starts with a great advantage in terms of goodwill. And he certainly, I think, will be able to make more progress on this front than the Bush administration, because it was pretty clear that a lot of other governments were not willing to grant to Bush administration even a small amount of leeway on some of these issues. But it's one thing to say, hooray for the new American president. It's another thing to say, all right, here's our troops for Afghanistan, or here's our prison cells for the terrorists. What do I think about the potential of eliminating the Electoral College? I think the likelihood of it is roughly the same as me being elected President of the United States in 2012. And that is not an announcement, by the way. I'll tell you why I don't like it, and it's got nothing to do with Bush versus Gore in Florida in 2000. The reason I like an Electoral College is because if I still ran presidential campaigns and you didn't have an Electoral College, I'll tell you exactly what I would do. I would rent an apartment for my candidate in Manhattan. I would rent another apartment for my candidate in Los Angeles, and another one in Houston, and another one in Chicago, and maybe a couple more around the country. And I would have my candidate spend 98% of his or her time in those six cities and ignore the rest of the country. Now, do states get ignored under the Electoral College? Well, maybe some, like ours. But I think on balance, having it does force the candidates to spread out across the country in a way that they would not, in a way that they'd not otherwise. There's been some talk here and in strong Republican-leaning states about sort of compromising on this and doing what the state of Maine and the state of Nebraska does. And rather than having winner take all and awarding an entire state's electoral count to the popular vote winner, but rather awarding one electoral vote to the winner of every congressional district. Hasn't worked yet because Republicans think it's a great idea in California and Democrats think it's a great idea in North Carolina because it creates an immediate partisan advantage. But I think something like that across 50 states might be a reasonable compromise between what you're talking about and the concerns with that I raised. Oh, I wish you'd stop the sentence right there. How do I see the legislature of Illinois' ability to take care of the governor's problems?
Well,
thank you. Thank you for being more specific. The original question was, do I see the Illinois state legislatures being able to solve their governor's problems? And I would suggest to you it would take a battalion of psychiatrists rather to solve the problems of the governor of Illinois. Will the legislature remove him from office? Sure they will. Will he go to prison? Maybe. It's sort of tradition in Illinois for governors go to prison after they leave office. But I would say, you never know, I grew up in Wisconsin, a little bit bitter feelings towards our urban neighbor. But I would say this. I don't have anything good to say about Governor Blagojevich. But technically speaking, if you listen to what he said on tape, I'm not certain he broke any laws. I don't know if it's against the law to speculate aloud that there are people who would commit valuable resources in exchange for a Senate seat. I don't think it's against the law to speculate aloud that if he chose to do something like that, it would be very valuable to him. What's against the law is actually doing it or offering it to someone. And if the special prosecutor, Mr. Fitzgerald, who we've seen in the past can be a little bit overzealous when circumstances occur, if Fitzgerald has information that has not yet become public, then perhaps Blagojevich will go to prison. That said, based on what we have now seen publicly, what he says sounds seamy, it sounds sleazy, it sounds disgusting, it sounds reprehensible, but I don't know if he broke any laws. So he's going to be impeached, he's going to leave office. After that, whether he goes to prison or whether he gets his own talk show, your guess is as good as mine. Or a hairdresser, exactly. When this topic comes up in Sacramento, I tell Governor Schwarzenegger's people to refer to it as the Granholm Amendment, because the governor of Michigan, Jennifer Granholm, was born in Canada, and it sounds less self-interested for him to talk about it that way. I don't think either's going to happen. There's no good reason that someone who's born in another country and immigrates here illegally and becomes a citizen should not be eligible for the presidency, but I can't see that a constitutional amendment taking place anytime in the immediate future. Similarly, I don't quite know why governors appoint senators. It was a process that was put in place at a time when communications was much more time-consuming, and having an appointment rather than an election made the process work much, much more quickly. And look how long it took for us to change that. I think both would be valuable changes. I don't think either one, I don't see either one happening in the near future, either separately or joint. What, to make it a one-term presidency? I don't think so. The question was, will we ever see the two-term constitutional limit on a president's service be extended or lifted? And I think not. People, even when they respect politicians, people don't trust politicians. And if you look at the debates that have taken place in California over term limits at the state level, the only way term limits have ever been extended is when they're framed as a way to screw over the politicians. So last year, Governor Schwarzenegger and the Democratic legislative leadership both endorsed a proposal to not to get rid of term limits in California, but to extend them. It lost. So even with a popular president, even with a well-respected president, I think voters are intrinsically suspicious of those who hold higher office, that they like to see some turnover. And just as a second quick point, I would suggest to you that even though there is a two-term limit on presidential people holding the presidency, certainly someone of the same party can run to replace a two-term president. And it has been more than, well, I would say this, since World War II, There has only been one occasion in which one party held the White House for three consecutive elections, when Ronald Reagan was elected twice and George Bush Sr. was elected to succeed him. So even if you can't vote for the same person for a third term, when Americans get the chance to vote for someone of the same party for a third term, they tend not to. I'm sorry, can you repeat the question? The controversy over Bloomberg's attempt to extend term limits in New York. I would just say that let's assume that Michael Bloomberg is an exception to all sorts of political rules, and this might be another one that's pretty difficult to apply on a level outside of New York City. I think it may actually happen, but I think it'd be awfully hard to apply those lessons anywhere else under other circumstances. Look. I'd like to take one more question, then if I could just indulge you for a couple of minutes before I let you flee. But I have a very insistent person back here. Oh, good. Well, the question is, Oprah Winfrey went on television and urged her audience not to spend money. So I guess there's two quick points I'd make. Number one is, if ever there's a president of the United States equipped to tell Oprah Winfrey what or what not to tell her audience, it is this one. But more broadly, and this gets to a pretty serious economic question, which frankly I'm not qualified to discuss at any length, so I'll just be glib and shut up. Generally, the one of the main reasons we got into this economic mess is people spending money too freely, people spending money that they didn't have. And so the lesson we are supposed to have learned, understandably and appropriately, from all that excess spending and excess borrowing is that we need to control ourselves. But the message that we're hearing, of course, is a little more complicated than that. It's like, all right, you need to learn how to control your spending, you need to know how to control your behavior, you need to rein things in, but not quite yet. So right now, we want you to spend a lot as quickly as you can to get the economy moving again. But once the economy's going again, we want you to start saving. And that is a pretty complicated message, and I'm not the one to judge whether Oprah Winfrey's the best one to deliver it or not, but I certainly see your point. You guys have been a terrific and a very, very patient audience, and I appreciate that. And I'm going to beg your patience for just one more minute, because I do want to spend just a minute telling you a little bit about what we're doing at the Jesse Unruh Institute, and so let you know, for those of you who haven't spent a lot of time on campus recently, about the extraordinary level of political activity and enthusiasm that we're seeing on campus. I was hired to take this job in August, and what I've told the dean is that when this job is filled again, and I hope that's not for a while, my friendly advice would be to hire the person not in August of an election year, but maybe a little bit before that. That said, between the first day of the Democrat convention and election day, we put on 27 events for students. We did convention watches, we did debate watches, we did election night watches. We did the weekly lunches that Carla was talking about. We sponsored events with guest speakers from across the political spectrum at every level of governance. And I have to tell you, I've been working in politics since 1984. I've been teaching, albeit one class a semester, since 1996. And I have never seen a group of young people as motivated, as engaged, and as involved in a campaign as I saw this last year. And some of that, a great deal of that, is Barack Obama, but I will tell you, the McCain supporters, they might have been like the Falklands fighting against the British, but man, they were just as involved, and they were just as devoted to what they were doing as the students for Obama were on behalf of their candidate. We co-sponsored Unruh some events with the Annenberg School for Communication. One, because that's where I started teaching at USC. Jeff Cowan, who was the dean then, reached out to me and asked me if I wanted to teach at a, I don't think he said warmer school, I think he just said better school than I was already teaching at. But also because, for those of you who've been at Annenberg, they got this really, really cool large screen TV, so it's a great place to watch conventions and debates and stuff. As it happened, the night of the first, and so we did our convention watches there for Obama's speech and McCain's speech. So the night of the first debate, the people from Annenberg said, oh, we've booked the hall for another event. And I said, well, it's the first presidential debate. How come? And they said, oh, it's a Friday night, Dan. And they said, college students on a Friday night, frankly, they got better things to do. And I said, well, I understand that, but my job is to run an Institute of Politics, and I'm going to run a debate watch. And even if only a dozen students show up for it, I think it's important for us attempting to establish ourselves on campus to do these things on a regular basis for those students who want them, they know there's somewhere they can go. So we sponsored a debate watch in Taper Hall. And on a Friday night, when I would suggest to you that every red-blooded 18, 19, 20, and 21-year-old in America had something much more fun to do with their time, we filled that place. We had students sitting on the floor. We had students sitting on the stairs. We had students outside the door craning their necks to listen in. And when it was over and I tried to send them home, we had a discussion after the debate that went on for an hour and a half before I finally threw them out. Debates, conventions, election night. And just this past week, we decided we wanted to put on a screening of the inauguration. And I was worried about this too, 8:30 in the morning. I don't know about you guys, but when I was a college undergrad, don't get me wrong, 7 wonderful years, but but I could count on the fingers of one hand the number of times I woke up before 8:30 in the morning. And so we got ground zero, the coffee house, figuring if we drew 100 people, we'd be thrilled. And in fact, if we drew 30 or 40, we'd just take a lot of the chairs out the back. Well, we filled ground zero. We filled the overflow room. And we filled the second overflow room. At 9 o'clock in the morning, we had 300 teens and early 20s, Republicans and Democrats, sitting there wanting to hear what their new president had to say. And after that event, like all of ours, we lead a discussion. And once again, I was worried that people were going to leave. They had to get under their classes. They had to go home and go back to sleep. So, man, Dianne Feinstein had barely uttered her last syllable, and I was up in front to make sure that people didn't leave. And once again, an hour later, I finally had to throw the students out of there because they wanted to stay. They wanted to talk. Carla mentioned perhaps the single best experience I've had in my relatively short time at the Unruh Institute. All election long, as she said, I would tell the students at our weekly campaign and lunches, we call them students talk back. Say, if somebody disagrees with you, they're your opponent, not your enemy. And over the course of the semester, I watched them, that when a student would ask an especially pointed question, they didn't get booed, but you'd hear sort of this murmur in the room, like, well, that's not the way we do things here. And on election day, I take that back, actually, the Friday before the election, the chair of the students for McCain and the chair of students for Obama, who'd gotten to know each other at these lunches, came into my office. They said, Dan, we got a problem. And I tell them, by the way, I said, you can call me either Dan or Mr. Schnur. Just don't call me Mr. Dan because I don't have the hairdressing credentials for that particular one. So I say, Dan, we've got a problem. I'm thinking, what possible problem could both the students for Obama and the students for McCain have? And the problem was, is a lot of the voter information guides that were supposed to be delivered to students had not been delivered. And a lot of students had either received no information or inaccurate information about their polling places. And they came to me together. Both had been working as hard as they possibly could, week after week, month after month, on behalf of their respective candidates. And 3 days before the election, they came to me together and said, we're worried that the students on this campus aren't going to have the voting information they need. What can we do? And we worked together across party lines to make sure that the University of Southern California students had the information that they needed in order to go vote on election day. And finally, 2 days after the election, and Carla mentioned this to you as well. 2 days after the election, I picked up the Daily Trojan, having no idea. And all semester long, every Wednesday, a student for Obama and a student for McCain had each written an op-ed on a different subject. Every Wednesday, there'd be two op-eds on education, on immigration, on economy, whatever the issue. And then we'd come together and talk about that issue. And on the Thursday after the election, the chair of the students for McCain and the chair of students for Obama wrote an op-ed together, saying we fought fiercely, We disagreed strongly, but the election is over and the challenges remain, and we're going to work together across party lines to make sure those challenges get solved. And I thought to myself, as impressive as it was that these hundreds of students are turning out for political events, they're cheering for their preferred candidate, even more exciting to me, even more compelling to me, is the idea that even in the middle of a hard-fought, bitter, and often nasty election, one of the lessons that the students took away from the conversations we've been having was you can work together across party lines. So coming back to the question that you asked earlier, I hope Barack Obama succeeds. Not because I agree with everything in his stimulus package, not because I think his policy agenda is perfect. But I think if I can watch a group of 19 and 20 and 21-year-olds hold to their principles, maintain their beliefs, but still find ways to work together in ways that benefit their campus community, well, then maybe there's hope for the rest of us too. Thanks very much for your time. What you were looking for.
Yeah, no, it's fantastic.
Oh, excellent.
All the people are going to come and try to use all your chocolate. I'll email you so we can get in touch.
I'll look forward to it.
Okay. I just want to tell you that I'm a graduate of the Annenberg School. And I have a son that graduated from the Marshall School, so it's really fun to be back, and I'm working in education.
Oh, that's terrific. What do you do?
I'm an academic advisor at Sandy Hills High School.
How do you like it?
I love it.
Good for you. It's
so
kind of fun.
I advise kids when they're going to school. So it's just fabulous.
Well, I know how you feel. I like it, too. Nice to meet you. Thanks for coming.
Well, your last story was heartwarming as somebody who is a member of the Trojan Mafia.
I should have.